Villages Suffield Zoning and Planning Commission. The following public hearing will be held on Monday, January 25th, 2016, at 7 p.m. at the Town Hall Meeting Room, 83 Mountain Road, Suffield, Connecticut. File 2015-4B, request for a text amendment to zoning regulations, section VW, keeping of chickens, section 3, limitations, specific statement concerning audible clicker alarms. Applicant, Zoning and Planning Commission. Mark Winger, Chairman, Jimmy Brummage, Secretary, appeared in the Harper Current on January 14th, 2016, and again on January 21st, 2016.
Thank you, Jimmy. First on the agenda this evening is an informal discussion on subdivision regulations relative to street lighting.
I brought with me a supplement that I'd like to pass around. Basically, my name's Leo Smith at 1060 Mapleton Avenue, Suffield.
No, before you start again, there's a recording device over there. I don't know, is that on? Chairman, do you need to be notified if that's running? Somebody's got a camera set. Is it running?
It is running.
It is running. Just to everybody know.
Okay. Just to give a little background, for the last 10 years, I've been on the Roadway Lighting Committee, part of the Illuminating Engineering Society of North America that sets the standards for roadway lighting nationally. Recently, we developed a design guide for roadway lighting that was just published this last September that addresses the issue of how to do street lighting in residential settings. One of the things that Suffield has is a subdivision regulation 918 that says that if you're a developer and you put in a subdivision road, you should put in lighting at what's called half code, which means that if according to design standards, you should put in a light, let's just say every 100 feet, go ahead, put it in every 200 feet. In other words, put in a light, skip a light, put in a light, skip a light. And one of the things that was addressed in this document was the issue of half code lighting. And in a nutshell, what it said basically was that putting in half-code lighting or lighting that does not meet what's called minimum standards is actually more detrimental to driver safety than putting in no lighting at all. And quite frankly, in Suffield, where you put in street lights on wooden utility poles, where spacing is based on wire weight distribution and not on light, it creates a problem in terms of driver vision, as does situations where you have lighting installed underground on these development roads. On the last page of the new supplement, the last two pages, I put together for Elaine Sarsinski a number of years back a basic chart that talks about how many feet all the subdivision roads have in between lighting, and also from the police reports, how many accidents occur during the day and how many occur at night. The second page shows what happens on the roads that we have that are subdivision roads that don't have any lighting. Quail Run Road is one example. And the number of accidents that actually occur at night on these roads with no lighting is actually less than the ones that have lighting. In a nutshell, basically it costs us $35,000 a year to pay the utility company for these lights, and they really don't serve a public purpose. If there were a case at all to be made, it might be that, well, lighting might make you feel comfortable. It might make you feel safe. And if that were to be the argument, then we need to take a look at what the fair, equitable system is for spending the tax dollars, so that if that is to be the case, then really anybody that feels comfortable with light should have the right to ask for it and get it in the same way that we provide, let's say, trash pickup for everybody, not just for people that live on this street or that street, but everybody gets it. And if we don't have the money to pay for everybody, then what we should do is basically look at not doing street lighting at all, except for those places that, where it would be a benefit, like for example, at an intersection. So that 918 could simply be reworded to say that if you put in a street, you have to put enough light at every intersection and leave it at that. instead of having half-code lighting going all the way down, it really does no good. So, with the new document and the recommendations against doing half-code lighting, and with the statistics from the police department that show that we really don't have a benefit for having the lighting, my request is to ask the town to consider rescinding 918 as it's written now, and maybe rewording it to require nothing more than a street light at an intersection where there would be some public benefit to that.
Can I ask Bill a question?
Sure.
Yeah. So Bill, when a subdivision comes in, who looks at the lighting? Town engineer, lighting requirements?
Both the town engineer and myself.
If we change the reg and we just set something more generic, like, you know, lighting, you know, in keeping with some design guidance, maybe this one or something else, would that be easier? Or if there's a half-code, something more comfortable enforcing?
Well, half-code makes it easy just in terms of every X amount of feet put it in. But frankly, I mean, the last couple of subdivisions, I don't believe developers have asked me, actually, we generally saying at intersection that if there's a long break in the road, the light up there. I don't think we really have followed the half-code lighting, at least the last few.
But the reg has it in.
The reg has it in there, fall back on. If we came up with something and just said, well, put a light at every intersection, kind of what we're doing now, if we had a relief valve where we could put another light or ask for another light or require it. Personally, my thoughts on street lighting are less is better. Well, actually, the way it's written is you're required for full code. You can ask for a partial waiver for half code. And that's generally what most developers have done. Leo, is anybody law enforcement folks been involved in the development of this?
Only in the sense that the Suffield Police Department supplied the accident reports over a 7-year time period.
Yeah.
Where we could go in and actually take a look at when it happened, so that was it a daytime accident or was it a nighttime accident, and then laying it out for the number of feet per road and figuring out on a per mile basis how many accidents occur during the day, how many occur at night, and for the ones that are, the streets that are lit, I think it was one accident for every, about half a mile, and it was roughly about the same for the ones that were unlit, maybe a little bit less. But we're paying $35,000 a year to the utility company right now for the lights that are just on those development roads. And the question is this really a good way to spend the money? Or
you say where, the HOA or the
town of Suffield? What happens is the developer puts in the street, then the town accepts the street. And once that happens, the town starts paying the bill to the utility company. So right now, we pay $35,000 a year or a little more to the utility company for the lights that are located on all of these subdivision roads. And if we took them all out and didn't have to pay the utility company anything, we wouldn't be degrading our level of safety in terms of, you know, people either driving or walking or whatever. So the question is, is this really a wise choice in the way of taking that $35,000 and spending it?
Are there any other correlations to crime, you know, that's kind of up or down, like when you remove lights?
There actually is, there are studies that show that crime has gone up where you have lighting. And I know that sounds a little weird, but in Chicago, for example, they took lighting and they put it in the alleys. People thought that it wasn't enough. they doubled the amount of the light and crime rate went up. They went back to the people that lived in the area and said, well, you know, the crime rate went up, would you like us to take the lights back down and remove them? And people by and large said they felt safer. Even if the crime rate went up, they still felt safer. And that's the, I've talked to other towns in Connecticut, and that is the primary issue about feeling safe. But again, the issue is we don't provide that for everybody. And so if we're sort of caught in a situation where either we should provide it for everybody, or if we don't have the resources to do that, then we should say, if you feel safe with light, go buy a light post, put it in your yard, turn it on when you want. It's all on you, right? You can do it. But don't ask the town to spend its resources to provide that light for you, because if we do it for you, we really have to do it for every other property owner. And we can't.
So quick question for you. I noticed Suffield Meadows, right? So they've got the development down there. I know a lot of people walk, especially this time of year, dark at 4:30. If the development itself decided that they wanted to power the lights that are already along Suffield Meadows Drive, would they be able to do something like that and have the association pay for it?
Say the last part.
Would it, let's say a development like that, if they decided that they wanted to have those lights on for safety, people walking, is there a way that we can bill the association for the use of the lights along Suffield Meadows Drive as an extension?
Number one, I'm not sure if you can bill the association. Number two, there is a special rate that was approved about 4 years ago by the Public Utility Control Authority that gives towns the right to switch over to midnight rates, so that instead of leaving a light on all night long, you can designate lights that are going to shut off at midnight. But the key is that in working with the utility company, you have to basically say to them, next time you come out to do your changeover of all the lights, we want you to switch these over to midnight rate, because it will cost an arm and a leg if you have them come out just to do that midnight rate on those 17 lights or whatever it is. But midnight rates will save money. Aside from the issue of your question as to whether or not you could build the association, my own personal feeling is you can't. And the reason is that if you build the association, that means that why aren't you billing everybody else? You know, the street lights in front of my house, why don't I get a bill? So there's some equitable treatment issue in terms of how you treat the association versus other individual homeowners. The other issue is looking at street lighting as to why we have it. Some towns have actually formed committees to look at street lighting where they would come up with the warranting criteria. Why do we need a street light? When is it proper to put one in? And what they do is they come up with the reasons, and then they go out and they actually inventory every street light in town and put a check mark if the street light meets one of those warranting criteria, and they put an X if it doesn't. In Hartford, Vermont, when they did that, about 2/3 of the street lights got X's. And quite frankly, most of the street lights in our town, I would say 80%, are probably not providing a safety benefit. If we get past the issue of whether they provide some feeling of comfort.
Near intersections, the poles and near the intersections, so the lights in the wrong place compared to over the intersection.
Intersections are a good place to light. And if we left all the lights there and then started taking down the ones that weren't there at the intersection and took the others down, I mean, it's not, and the municipal budget is not, you know, everything, but still, we're spending over $70,000 a year now for street lighting, and what are we getting for it?
Was there a cost to taking it down?
Under the Department of Public Utility Control, there is what's called a 14-year premature abandonment rule. And the way it works is this. If the utility company comes in and puts a street light in and keeps it there for 14 years, the municipality can say, take it away, we don't want it anymore, and they have to do that, and there's nothing that has to be paid. If you do it after 7 years, and the original value of the street light with labor and everything, well, let's just say $350, you have to pay half of that to the utility company for taking it down prematurely. So the trick would be to look at the street lighting and say basically to the utility company, take down all the lights that are 14 years or more, except for those located at the intersections or whatever other designations, dangerous curbs or other places that would be looked at. So at 14 years, everything comes down unless it is oranged. And then perhaps in another 5 or 6 years down the road, do the same thing again for those lights that are not.
95% of the lights are over
14 years old. Yeah. We have lights that were installed in the 60s here in Suffield. And even aside from the light itself, when you really get into it, it's amazing what happens with street lighting where you have a 250-watt street light here and 150-watt right next to it. Why? What's the difference? When Elaine was first elected, and we did something where CLNP had to put in fully shielded lighting in 5 locations on Main Street. When they did that, we designated that they would drop the street light level down to 70 watt. Now, that was a significant drop from the 150 watt that it used to be. But the trick was that Elaine never said anything to anybody. She never said, hey, you know, to the town, here's what we're doing, what do you think, right? Because there would probably be a lot of resistance. But having not said anything to anybody, it was very interesting that when those street lights got switched over, there was not one word from anyone that said, hey, you know, I think these are a little darker, what's going on? No one noticed.
I don't know if no one noticed. Maybe they just didn't say anything. I've had people say that the streets in Suffield are dark. I mean, I've heard people say that just in conversation, that there's really not enough lighting in the streets. And I know you say that it won't cause more accidents. It just doesn't seem right that it wouldn't cause more accidents. I mean, you won't see a kid riding a bike if it's dark. I mean, I would hate for someone to get hurt over saving a little bit of money. Has any other towns adopted this? And we've seen that it actually doesn't cause more accidents?
I could do some more research for you on that issue, all right? Like, for example, in the town of Hartford, Vermont, where they actually did, they actually took down about half of their lights and find out from them what kind of repercussions happened.
I'd like to know that.
Okay.
Issue with the half-coat lights, though, is if you're on a longer street, let's see now, as you go from light to dark and your eyes go this entire time.
That's exactly the issue. That's exactly what it is basically is this. You're supposed to say if the maximum amount of brightness is directly under the street light. So you have a street light here and a street light there. The amount of light that you have in between is supposed to be no less than 20% of the light that you have at maximum. And that ratio is by the committee in terms of the roadway lighting on how you do roadway lighting, and that's responsible for when you have, let's say, on an interstate highway, that determines how many poles you have and how far apart they are and how high the light is and what the wattage is of the light, all that, because that ratio needs to be maintained. When you split the distance by putting them up on wooden utility poles, because that saves money, right, the distance becomes too great and you no longer have that. And even on Main Street, we have places where it's this pole, skip a pole, that pole. If you're talking wooden utility poles, it's sort of way out of line in terms. If you had the committee come and do an assessment in Suffield, I would say probably 80% of the streetlights in town would be non-conforming. And the key thing in the document that I provided was the part that said that it actually would be safer from a driver perspective in terms of collision avoidance and so forth to have no lights at all than it would be to have that light, dark, light, dark, light, dark situation where you have the lights too far apart.
Where is that? Is that just based on your study?
This is the document, and this wasn't my study, this was the committee's recommendation. It's on the second page there.
Of this?
Yeah. And it's really that last paragraph, and the sentence before the last paragraph that touches on the issue of safety in terms of it being safer not to light at all.
I mean, to me, for us, I mean, the existing lights in the town and whether they save money, but that's selectmen kind of issue. We just need to give clear guidance to the developers going forward, you know, what's the rules, right?
Yeah.
And I don't know if this is like a committee thing, we set it up and look at it, maybe there's some potential savings, or, yeah, it's nice that we have an expert in town, it's awesome.
So if the rule were changed to basically say put the light at the intersection and maybe even other places as designated by the town planner, let's say, you would give them some leeway so that if there were in this development some type of radical curve in the road that warranted lighting, that there would be an opportunity there to say we feel that you should also have a light here at this radical curve.
Well, you're talking, is that all part of the state road too? Or the state roads, are those the same? You're grouping them all in with all your specific state roads and town roads?
No, the statistics that I did there.
Yeah, was, just town roads.
Yeah, and they are listed by road so that every single street that was a subdevelopment road was analyzed for the number of streetlights on that road and for what the spacing was of those streetlights. And then that second page was the page that showed, how about the roads where we didn't put any lights in at all for a subdivision? And what was the accident rate between the two in terms of miles of road versus accident and so forth, accidents during the day, accidents at night.
A change in the regs would only be prospectively.
Yes.
Yeah, we would leave the ones that are there.
Bob?
Yeah.
I was going to say, Mr. Chairman, we can take it under advisement. I mean, I know I haven't gotten back to the subdivision regulations in a little bit now, but I have done a fair amount of work on them in the past to update and upgrade. Fairly soon, so I feel an appropriate time to take this discussion.
Mm-hmm. Any other commission members, any questions for Leo?
My only question on the money saving issues and things like that, from the time you've taken this to select them?
I've asked for an appointment with this select woman and given her the same information that I've given here. And the whole process there would be to form a task force that would have representatives, let's say someone from police, someone from fire, someone from public works, that would all get together to set that criteria on why we need a street light, when we need it, and then do the analysis that would do the same thing that they did in Hartford, Vermont, to say, okay, this is a check mark because it's warranted, and this is not a check mark because it's not warranted, and actually see what we come up with.
It'd be nice to find a development in town that would try it for a year. Drop the lights and see whether the light's any different or not. Myself, I've enjoyed a lot of the light looking kind of outside my window. It's great.
There's 92 homes on Quail Run Road that have never been lit because when that development went in, this was before the development regulation was adopted, there were no streetlights put in there. So you have a sort of a test right now of what a development is like with no lights.
and they have these moneymaker fees, so it's like a free rent, they just keep getting, and they hope you kind of forget about it, and just keep paying. Because it's not needed, it's just flat.
Thanks very much, Eric.
Okay. Thank you.
Next, I'd like to open the public hearing. 2015-4B, request for text amendment of zoning regulations. Section 5W, keeping the chickens, section 3, limitations, specific statements, including auto fire alarms. Zoning and planning commission. Bill, you want to discuss this?
Sure, just briefly, I mean, I think everyone knows why we're here. This last sentence, audible predator alarms are prohibited on properties less than 5 acres, came into the regulation, well, it wasn't discussed during a public hearing before it got put into the text. The final public hearing that we did have, that language was in there, but it wasn't really discussed. And so some members of the public, Mr. Fene and Ms. Morbino, brought that to everyone's attention. Commission decided to have a public hearing on that sentence, and here we are. We did send it to CROG, I expect there were no issues from their perspective, so. Here we are.
Well, just keep the record clear, would you read that to us?
Sure, the paragraph on limitations, I'll just go through the whole thing for you. The keeping of chickens shall be for personal or household use only. The owner of the chickens must be a resident of the dwelling situated in the lot where they are kept. The chickens shall be kept to the owner's property at all times and should not be permitted to roam onto adjacent properties. Building is required for housing chickens. And then audible predator alarms are prohibited on properties less than 5 acres. And the idea was if chickens are allowed on properties as small as a quarter acre, it's likely houses will be close if there's an alarm that makes noise, when the predators try to get in the chicken coop or what have you. Commission thought it may be, that would be a bad thing. And if you have a farm, fine, that's why we're limiting it to 5 acres or more. Really, that's.
At this point, I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone that would like to speak? Tom?
Hey, Tom Fene, Warner Town Road. No streetlights on Warner Town Road.
Would you like one?
No. Actually, the question earlier that Jeff had, I think the streetlights in Suffield Meadows are all paid for by the association. I don't think the town pays for any of those. But anyhow, on this particular item, I just want to refer back to the letter I sent November 10th. Some of this, most of what's in there now is, doesn't matter, but the two issues that I raised, I wanted to emphasize again were, first of all, I'm not at all familiar with predator alarms, and there was nothing in the discussion ever. What Bill said tonight was the first I've heard any discussion about them. So I gather that sometimes chicken owners will have predator alarms to keep the foxes away or whatever. And I guess you can have silent ones and audible ones, since this just talks to audible ones, but I don't know enough about them. Maybe somebody else can talk about them. But the thing that made me think the most about it was that the proposal prohibits them for chicken owners only on small lots. Doesn't prohibit them for people that have horses or cats or dogs or whatever. So, if I live on a quarter acre, I can have a predator alarm unless I have a chicken, according to what you're proposing to do. So I'm not sure that's what you want to do. That's part of my question about why you would have it only under the chicken, household chicken section. It seems to me like something like this really ought to be part of what you have as tools to talk to neighbors, that the zoning enforcement official could talk to neighbors about to keep neighbors from not getting pissed off at each other. So the idea that somebody could put in a predator alarm that doesn't have an audible piece to it would be something that would be good to be able to tell somebody that's got a problem. I don't think it's needed in the regulations. Do you have lots of predator alarms that are going off and annoying people right now? I don't think so. So why add this in? And so part of it is don't add a regulation that you don't have any real need for. If you already said you're gonna come back in a year, look at the chicken regulations and decide if they need to be adjusted. I don't think you need it at all, and I haven't heard a case that suggests you do, especially only for people that have chickens. So why single out somebody that has chickens to not have an audible alarm, but somebody else could have an audible alarm if they don't have chickens? That's my story. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Anybody else?
Ann Lewis, North Grand Street. I have poultry. And I think Tom raises a really interesting point. I use a predator alarm per se, but it's a silent one, just red flashing lights that you put at a height that whatever animal comes in. I've never heard of anything other than that, and that works well. But when you start to think of the ramifications, I also have a laser that goes across where I have my eggs for sale when I've got them out, because I've been robbed a number of times, and it dings. It does a very audible ding. Is that considered, could that not be considered a predator alarm? And yet my neighbor across the street who sells wreaths has the same thing. Does that allow you to start to say, well, we're kind of ticked at that person, so we're gonna call it a predator? So I think Tom raises a very interesting point. The same alarm that I have on my property, she has, that's where I learned it from, but according to this, if I didn't have 5 acres, it would be an issue. And that's pretty much all I have to say. That, and I'm really disappointed with all the discussion that we had concerning this, all the many, many meetings, that this was sort of snuck in at the last minute and never opened up for discussion. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Kathy?
Kathy Mormino, 519 South Stone Street. I share the concerns that have already been stated and would like to add a little bit of procedural history just for the record, because I know some members haven't been with us for the past 2.5 years that we've been kicking chickens around the block. And we all worked a very long time to come to the proposed regulation that was passed without the audible predator alarm language in it. And I think the commission was happy with it. The public was happy with it. And it was noticed to the public. It was published in the paper, wherever that happens, and put online. Subsequent to that, the former first selectman, Ed McEnany, approached the zoning department, Mr. Hawkins, in person, and indicated to him that he wanted this audible predator alarm language added to the regulation, which is curious in and of itself. That's not usually how we do things procedurally after a proposed language has already been noticed. Poor Mr. Hawkins was put in a position that he had to do something with that mandate. So he emailed or talked to some members of the commission. The members of the commission said, hey, sounds all right to me. It doesn't sound like anybody could possibly complain about that. Makes sense. In a vacuum, it makes sense. If you don't know where Mr. McEnany got this little gem of an idea to tuck this sucker into the language and hope that it gets past the goalkeeper without being noticed. Where it comes from is, what are you doing there? Rolling marbles down the rolling marbles down the auditorium. So where it comes from is my neighbor back before I was a farm complained to everybody that would listen, the health department, the wetlands department, the zoning department, the police department, and the fire department have all made their way to my house at one point or another, all with unfounded complaints by my neighbor. And this was my neighbor's Hail Mary pass on the eve of the settlement, the last settlement conference, with a judge in Hartford Superior Court. So his last gasp effort to try to stick it to me was to say, well, she's got an audible predator alarm, and that disturbs us too. So all the rest of the neighbor complaints about the rooster and the chickens had gone away, and he figured he'd toss in an additional noise complaint that didn't have feathers or wings. So that's where this whole thing comes from. I'm positive I'm the only person in the history of Suffield to ever have a predator alarm in my yard. It was given to me by a sponsor to test it out. They don't work. I don't recommend them. They're a bad idea, particularly if you're going to be on quarter-acre lots close enough to annoy somebody with them. But they're only activated if an actual predator is near them in the middle of the night, or whenever you have them set to. So they're pointless, and they've never been a problem in this town, and except now that they're messing up this regulation that we all worked so hard to come to, because I think the manner in which this audible predator alarm issue got stuffed into the regulation could make the entire regulation an appealable issue. I know you're trying to rectify the violation of the Sunshine Laws issue now, but I'm not sure this does that. So I think if there's I'm happy that Mr. Lena's here, because I'm hoping that he can speak to the issue of to this issue and whether it would hold up on appeal if you were to go ahead and approve it tonight. I'm not sure that this meeting rectifies the original error that was made in adding this on and approving it in the first place. So this was originally, passed in violation of the Sunshine Laws. We're trying to fix it here. I don't know if that can happen. But I know that Attorney Landolina previously cautioned against sort of a similar provision a couple years ago when we were talking about hobby farms and having 4-H students have an exception where they can keep a chicken or chickens as their project animals. And he said, you don't want to create a separate class where you're modifying the code just for a certain class of people. And I think that's what is happening here, sort of in a reverse way. You're not giving something additional. You're taking something additional away from people who fall within this zoning regulation. And I think that is some sort of reverse discrimination. My neighbor who did the complaining, so he has, 2 acres? I have 5 acres now. The insanity of adding this to this section of the code is that he could keep a predator alarm on his property, but if I only still had 2.5 acres, just like he does, I couldn't because I have chickens. That makes zero sense. So it's pointless to have this in there. It's not a problem in town. Alarms of any sort are not a problem in town. They never have been. They're never going to be. I mean, I think as Ann indicated, we're going to be revisiting this as a community in a year to look at the whole chicken thing to see how it's working out. I think if at that time we find out that audible predator alarms are causing an issue, then you look at it then. But I don't think this is enforceable. It's a real slippery slope, and I don't think it's one that you should get on. Who's going to enforce it? The police department, the animal control officer, the zoning enforcement officer? I mean, if you want a noise regulation in Suffield, make a noise regulation. I don't think sticking a noise regulation within a chicken keeping regulation is sensible zoning. So let me just see if I have anything more. I think that's pretty much it, but I would love for Attorney Landolina to speak to the legal issues surrounding this if you haven't already consulted with him about it. Has Mr. Landolina been consulted, Mr. Chairman?
I haven't spoken.
You haven't. So he's here. He's getting paid. Yeah. Would you mind speaking to that? Can I ask?
No.
This is the first I've heard of this, so I would decline to speak to it at this point. If you want me to answer some questions or a written opinion or next time, I'd be glad to do it, but I don't want to, probably too important to give you some off the cuff kind of thing.
That's fair.
I generally say that, if you have a problem with noise, there should be a noise ordinance in town. And I don't know what there is. I assume that there isn't. Although noise ordinances are tough to enforce, right, and represent.
Tough to even figure out.
And one of the towns I represented a few years ago had a noise ordinance. They didn't have a decibel meter to, you know, so if there was a complaint, they had to hire a specialist to come in. $400 or $500 a visit, so. But I think you are correct that one way to deal with it would be in a larger global context of having the town adopt a noise ordinance. The rest of it I really can't comment on at this point. But since it's your application, you're under no obligation to close the public hearing tonight or make a decision tonight, you know, timeframes don't apply to you, so you can, you know, do whatever you'd like.
Does anybody else have anything they'd like to speak in favor or against?
Can I just implore the commission to act on it tonight so that we don't have to come back? We don't want to talk about chickens anymore. There are more pressing town issues, really. This isn't a problem. So that's all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
People have any wishes whether they want to close the public hearing now or keep it open?
Personally, I would love to close this.
We'll want to move on. I'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Public hearing is closed. Next public hearing. Request for a text move to add a new section 5.10 large scale ground mounted solar photovoltaic installations for the zoning regulations applicant. Zoning and Planning Commission, beginning from our November 16th. Bill?
Yes. Okay, last month the commission had asked me to look at basically how these large scale solar installations are taxed. So I met with the assessor, and it's interesting because the upshot is there's no certainty that we can tax these right now. So I'm not sure what that does in terms of your thinking on either adopting or tabling or just withdrawing it there at this point. But in essence, I had met with her prior to our December meeting, and I had some idea of what she's dealing with regard to the large-scale system on North Street, Lone Star Energy, the 2-megawatt project. And she told me at that time that the attorney for Lone Star sent her an email and said, we think we're exempt from property taxes based on this section of statutes. And I have that section. It's 12-8157D. And I can pass copies of that around if folks are interested. It's kind of hard to dissect, looking at it, but that's the statute they're reciting. And I mentioned that the assessor disagreed with that opinion, and she thinks that, they are taxable. And then there's another section that just became effective June 30th, 2015. It's 12-8157 subparagraph F, which talks about the municipality's legislative body may vote to abate up to 100% of the property taxes due for any year. I have a copy of that as well.
We can't presume that they exist in order to abate them.
Right. So there's really no finality to this. There's no, she's not sure they're right. She thinks she's right. But like I said, the upshot is there's no certainty that these aren't taxes. So, you know, with that, I'm not sure, again, what the commission wants to do with this text amendment. It is our application, so, you know, we're not under the strict timeframes of others. But we're not sure when this will get decided either. The assessor's been in contact with several other towns, and we connect the assessors association and other groups trying to get an answer to this, and she hasn't found one yet. So, the thing with the Lodestar project is they've volunteered, they've agreed to enter into a payment in lieu of taxes to the town, so she's trying to work out the details of that. However, just because they're doing it doesn't mean someone else that comes in and wants to build one of these is going to volunteer as well, so.
That's not an uncommon outcome for power projects, though.
Yeah.
Negotiating projects.
Yeah. So.
Keeping our lawyers and litigating papers.
So that's kind of what I found out with regard to the taxing district. Right now, we can't say that we will be able to. Other than that, nothing in the text has changed. It's largely as it was from the beginning. Any questions or thoughts on that?
Is there a concern that, because of the person planning the solar array would meet the regulations, that then we'd be inundated with people setting those up and lose tax dollars? Is that what the concern is?
I think the concern was if we're going to allow these in most every zone in Suffield, we may use land that could be better utilized by a building that would generate, you know, significant taxes as opposed to something like this where we may not get any taxes or even enter into an agreement which may not give you as much taxes. I don't think these are going to be popping up on the best land Suffield has, you know, likely in the industrial area if there's good land that's not full of wetlands down there. You know, you'd like to think that you'll get, you know, a large building with lots of equipment in it that will produce a lot of taxes for the town. But if it's allowed in the zone, someone could potentially apply for one of these here, and like I said, right now we're not certain we can tax them. So that was kind of the reason I was asked to look into it. And I was not aware of that until I met the new assessor. So.
Because one solution would be to take it out of the industrial zone.
Could do that. And you're just limiting it to residential areas.
More farm areas.
Farm, right, yeah.
The residential areas already have the right to do on the roofs. This is, if I remember, was that in between, between residential and the big ones.
The same counts here. Between, well, I have 250 kilowatts to, 1 megawatt, I'm sorry.
We could just table this until we get an answer from the tax assessor, right? We don't have to make a decision on it.
We don't have to, and if this is something that is, you know, deciding factor, then we should wait, and there's no reason to do this now. We can leave it on the agenda and, you know, just continue it until we know. I just don't.
We can do it for the two zones, so at least we'd allow one in an agricultural area. And very frankly, the only place that needs to be is near water, so it's state highway and water.
Free phase wire.
But you're still converting taxable land into non-taxable land?
But we have a very small amount of industrial land, so they hate to lose it to something that doesn't generate.
Right, but you know, if you put our farmland, it could have been resi land. Most of resi land here is most farmland. Over time, you can convert taxable land into non-taxable land. So I'd like to understand the taxation. Rules before we even grant any of this as a bill.
Yeah.
These are that.
Yeah, understanding things.
This
like
is already
this.
Large.
Yeah. It's such a good yeah, I could keep checking in with the assessor. I just don't have a timeline, time frame for when she's
going to. How are they going to resolve this dispute?
They're working on a plan. Right, that means this doesn't get decided, they're just volunteering.
Yeah, they're not gonna pay a pilot if they prevail under it.
Again, we just, we don't have certainty.
If I may, if 8157D was so clear on its face, so as to exempt them from paying taxes, they would never be able to pay anything to the town. Now, I was involved in Summers, and we were the first large-scale array project. And I don't know if they ended up doing the development, but they, when they first approached the farmer and later on the town, their biggest issue was the taxation of this use. And they made it very clear that they were, the next stop was to the legislature. Because in other states, they do, these kinds of operations don't pay property tax. Now, I've read that statute four or five times. I'm not an energy lawyer, and every word in there is a word of art. Almost every, you know, except for maybe a couple of ands. So it's something that you should probably check in with the town attorney. Beyond the scope of my representation of the town, to give an opinion on that. But it would seem to me that OPM should have an answer. I mean, that's who the town clerks work with, or the assessors work with very closely. The project in Summers was built before that, the first section, which is D, got passed, and certainly before F was passed. But you're right that F seems to imply if these things are. If you can enter into an abatement or tax agreement with an owner, that means to me they're taxable. Otherwise, it would make no sense for F to be there if D took care of the issue. And I read D, and again, words of art, and I'm not an engineering attorney, but I read D to mean if I have a solar project on my industrial building, which could be, let's say, the Dollar Tree warehouse, which is 1 million square feet. That's a lot of roof space. If I have a solar project that put panels on that roof to supply my own energy needs, I think that that's what that section is talking about, that those panels are exempt. And if I use up 1 kilowatt or whatever, I don't, whatever, so many kilowatt hours, and that's what the system's rated for, and I'm not net metering back to, you know, the grid, then I'm exempt. That seems to imply, though, if I'm net metering back to the grid, I'm making money from my project, so I'm producing a lot more energy than I need, or I don't even have, like these guys or the guys in Summers, there's no building attached to those projects, but all of this being sent right out to the grid, but that's something different. And I think that's what that statute is trying to get at. You know, that's my read of it, but it would seem to me that OPM should have an answer.
Did you ever speak to the Economic Development Commission?
I did talk to Patrick. They were, you know, initially in favor because they thought of some sites in the light industrial zone. I mentioned after meeting the assessor that he may not be able to tax them. I haven't been to a couple of Economic Commission meetings since the assessor. I suspect the problem is.
Mr. Hawkins, could you speak up, please? I can't hear you.
Sorry. I said I have met with the Economic Development Commission on this because I just met with the assessor a couple of weeks ago. But I suspect they'll probably say the same thing, and that if we're not certain we can tax these, we probably don't.
Carl's principle, talk with the town council, and opinion that it is, and DDC.
Yeah, I think.
Kind of big, you know, easier to support it.
I think I need to dig into this some more.
My gut is that all of Carl's arguments
Yeah, I believe it's our assessor, she thinks they are too, it's just a matter of getting a decision, I guess.
Does anybody have any questions? Keep the public hearing open?
Yep, I would continue it to February meeting.
Mr. Chairman, there are people here, I don't know if anyone might speak on this, but since the hearing is open, you have to take public comment.
Thank you. Anybody like to speak in favor of this? Against? Indifference?
Curious.
Motion to?
Yeah, motion to keep the hearing open until the next meeting or until the input comes back.
Motion made and seconded, keep public hearing open, all those in favor?
Aye.
Yes? Old business, discussion of possible decision on file 1542, the honorable warrants. Do you have any thoughts, Mr. Sheriff? Discussion?
I just wanted to make a couple of comments on that, the intention of the zoning planning commission was not to slip anything in. It was kind of a, we didn't, I guess for lack of better thing, we didn't know that we couldn't kind of vote the email, we sent it around, it sounded reasonable, but it's like, oh yeah, that's a good idea, you know, these alarms going off. So I just wanted to clarify that, you know, it wasn't intentional for us to do anything, and then,
like that is one of those kind of lessons that we did learn, the danger of email. It's not the right way to communicate before, maybe it's not generally done. I think we're trying to expedite things, and since we'd all seen it via email, we thought it would discuss here. We realized after the fact it hadn't probably been, so lesson learned. And if we are going to read, there may be times when things do exchange during emails, but important that should that ever happen, we make sure we read the record at the next meeting.
And then my second comment was that they were asking why the draft regulations regarding predator alarms specifically for chickens, and I think it's only because we learned that there wasn't anything for chickens, so we've been working on drafting some regulations regarding chickens, where the horses and all the rest of them have just kind of been there forever. So that's just another thing that, that's why this audible alarm thing was addressed for the chicken thing, because we worked on the chicken thing for a couple of years, so.
I do have one question, okay. Right now, this is in the regulation.
The other thing I wanted to clear up, one other question, it was noticed this way, with this text.
Correct. This was,
what was it?
We had a meeting in October, which the landlord denied, and then there was a draft to that effect that went on the internet, and then the language was put in. It was also replaced the previous draft. The notice was the general notice that this was the regulation, this is the meeting. So it wasn't a notice, it was properly that it was a public hearing. We had a public hearing, it just was never really discussed more than me saying these were the changes that were made, predator alarm. I think I may have even said it just like that, and there was no discussion on it.
Thoughts of keeping it in or taking it out, or which way we'd like to proceed?
Well, how about we revisit it in the year? Since we have to revisit anyway.
Leave it in the regulation the way that it is?
Yep. Chairman, right? So, it's in the regulation now.
Yes.
Improperly in the regulation, arguably.
Arguably. When was the regulation adopted?
November 5th was the effective date.
2015. And you noticed that tonight, add this in, or to do what, I'm not sure, what is the purpose of tonight's public hearing and discussion? What is the application?
An attempt at a do-over, to put that sentence in.
Add it in, not to repeal it.
Is to hold a public hearing on that sentence.
It'd be easier if there was a motion to strike it and repeal it.
You can't, if the purpose of tonight's public hearing is to add it in because you thought
it's on that end.
Request for a text amendment to zoning regulations, keeping a chicken section 3 limitation specific statement concerning auto predator alarms.
The idea was we wanted to have a public hearing on that one sentence. It was already in the regulation.
It seems to me that a reasonable person looking at this document and reading the public notice, you take that to mean that you are adding this and not deleting it. So that you haven't given fair notice to people who thought it was already in there and would object to it being removed. Keeping in mind that the regulation as adopted apparently included this language in that regulation, the appeal period to challenge that regulation presumably has run 15 days after the notice was published in the paper. So, my recommendation, and I can look into it further and have discussions with Bill, but my recommendation is to take no action at this point until we figure out. It sounds to me like it's already there. So if you're trying to remove it, and if you think that, let's say, denying or voting against this amendment is going to somehow delete it, I don't think that that's accurate. I think that that might be a problem.
You don't think it was a problem that it was added in violation of the sunshine laws?
I since I don't know the circumstances, I can't comment.
This was our attempt to cut it.
I understand.
Fix it. It doesn't seem like it was our best attempt, but it didn't dawn on me until the discussion.
But I would suggest, and you can withdraw the application. You're prerogative to do that. And the regulation will be whatever the regulation is. As to what that is, I guess I'd have to talk to Bill and figure out exactly what that is. But there's also, if there was a notice problem, and that's what we're talking about, then the appeal period is actually extended beyond the 15 days.
Can you say that again?
If there is a problem with notice, then the appeal period of 15 days doesn't apply.
If there's a problem with notice of 2015 or tonight's?
Not tonight, because they haven't done anything.
Okay, so if there's...
2015.
But if there's a problem with whatever action was taken in November, and there is a problem with notice, not what was discussed at the public hearing, because there are many regulations that are adopted that are pages and pages and pages long, that every little sentence, or every little paragraph is not discussed. It's there. The purpose of the notice is to give people a chance to review the entire text beforehand. Be prepared to talk about whether they object or not object to the regulation and come in prepared to say, I like this chicken section, but I think the audible predator alarm section should be deleted. I don't, again, I wasn't involved in the 2 years of the chicken thing. So,
it was properly noticed.
I don't believe it was properly noticed. It's just a matter of how that sentence got in there. It just wasn't discussed at a public hearing to be put in.
There were two notices.
Well, I think we left
there. There was one public notice.
that was changed.
The public notice wasn't changed.
It wasn't.
Let me just say, I don't think it's appropriate for you to be discussing whether a notice from 4 months ago was, now, that's kind of a legal question.
A legal notice.
So,
On a website.
But if you've got some concerns about whether this should be in there or not, I would suggest that you can withdraw it. And then, if you want, I can give you an opinion as to whether I think it was properly adopted. And if you don't care whether it was properly adopted, and you don't like it and you want to take it out, then withdraw your application and start again. Notice a public hearing saying that you're going to repeal this section to the extent that it was in there at the beginning. I don't know if somebody's neighbor thinking that, oh, they're adding this in, that's great. And tomorrow they find out, oh, they really took it out, is going to have a problem.
What's your pleasure with the alarm? Let's do a straw vote on the poll to either keep the auto alarm in or take it out and figure out what the procedure is the best way to go. Jack?
Leave it in.
Yeah, leave it.
Brendan?
Well, I agree with Tom and Carl. I think that the law should be more encompassing, not just mentioned on chickens, but until we have something that does encompass that, I say just leave it where it is.
Well, it sounds like the consensus is to... public hearing is closed. We can either vote.
I guess my suggestion would be to withdraw the application. I'm not going to change anything.
I'll leave it in place and then we can go find it and see if there's something.
I can talk to Carl and make sure that what happened in the fall, how it was done, was okay. I think it is.
Do you like to make a motion? Someone like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to withdraw the application.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Stand.
Okay. Discussion of possible decision on file 2015-10. Solar. New business, file number 2016-1, request for a special permit for commercial greenhouse at 268 Pool Road, map 24 and 29, block 26, lot 91 and 39, applicant Four Seasons Farm LLC, accept and set a public hearing. Next one?
Yeah, February 22nd, regular meeting recommended. This is the tomato greenhouse. The folks came in informally a couple of months ago. First phase of it, yep, we have some plans in front of you to review prior to the first phase is about 11 and a half acres for covering the site. February 22nd.
Those plans are to bring to the next meeting that I distributed tonight.
Do you make a motion?
Yeah. That's just stupid. Yeah, the answer is that just short.
What was that?
Make a motion to 2016-1 for next month meeting.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Oh, just an orange. Motion carries. That completes our business for the evening. Carl.
All right. Good evening. So, I see a lot of new faces. I don't come here every month, but just introduce myself. I'm Carl Landolina. We're the firm of Fagan Landolina on Spring Street in Newsalot. I've been in practice for, this is my 30th year actually. But I think I've been representing the Planning and Zoning Commission for about 5,000 years, I want to say. At least, yeah. I was around in 2004 when the major rewrite was done, 12 years ago, yeah, maybe even longer. those are Phil Chester days, that's a name probably some of you don't know. So Bill and I had talked that, because there's a lot of new people here on the commission, that would be a good idea if I came. You know, certainly I'd be glad to come back more than once to talk about topics that I thought might interest you. But not that being on the zoning commission is rocket science, it's not. Having been on a commission, I can tell you firsthand that it's not. But, you know, Bill thought it was, and I thought it would be a good idea also to kind of start with like a zoning 101 for some of the newer members. And I apologize if I talk about stuff that's so basic that you all know it, but I don't know what anyone knows or doesn't know. So that's what I'd like to do. Now, there are academies you can go to, there's all these seminars, and there's some great zoning lawyers that Mark Grant might just some names you may know that, you know, teach these classes to new commissioners. Sometimes it's hard to get away for a full Saturday to go, or 5 hours on a weekday or something like that. So I offered up my services to Bill, and he said, come on down. So tonight what I'd like to talk about is sort of the unglamorous stuff and being on the commission. And this is something that we're talking about the procedure and how things get done. Now, a lot of commissions that I've seen, and I sat on one myself, they rely heavily on the town planner and staff to be sort of the lookout for the procedural part of it. And I always thought that that was not a great idea, not that you have competent staff, you're very competent staff. But it's great for each of you to know how an application is submitted and processed, and what steps you're legally required to go through to process those applications. Because as you know, much of what you do is very time sensitive. There are statutes that tell you how long you have to act. And if you miss some of those by even one day, you could end up in a project being approved that you didn't intend to be approved. So the process is very important. Most cases, probably 60% of zoning cases that get appealed, that are overturned, decisions by the commission that are overturned on procedural grounds, where there was a mistake somewhere along in the process. You have a lot of discretion as far as the courts are concerned. They don't typically interfere. As long as you make the decision that's reasonable and supported by the record, they're not going to sit in judgment of you and say, well, if I was on that commission, I would have decided this application differently. That's not what the courts intend to do. But they will overturn cases if you make even the smallest of procedural errors. So I thought tonight we'd talk about the process. So typically, you know that there are 4 or 5 different kinds of applications. You're a combined planning and zoning commission. Some towns have separate planning and zoning commissions. It's about half and half in the state. You're combined, which means you're going to see all of these applications come before you. There's a site plan application, which is sort of the lowest form of an application that you would see. There's a special use permit application. These are two zoning applications, special permit. There are text amendments, which you can file yourself, as you know, or applicants come. And I, and my partner and I, we do that regularly. We go in and we ask commissions to change their regs to suit the needs of our clients. There are boundary line adjustments where you can change zones. You can enlarge or decrease a zone. I think you had one of those last month.
Yep.
With a piece of property on Mapleton. Then there are subdivision applications. All of those are the kinds of applications that you generally see come before you. So in terms of the process, and I know you have in some parts of your regulation a pre-application, either a requirement or an allowance for applicants to come and speak to you before they actually file an application and say, hey, I'm thinking about doing this. It's a little bit unusual. Am I wasting my time? That's a great tool. Until a few years ago, it wasn't permitted, although we did it all the time anyway. Because we thought it was a great tool. So, aside from that, when an applicant decides that he wants to file an application, no matter what it might be, He goes down, talks to Bill, talks to staff, hires an engineer, a surveyor, typically, sometimes a lawyer, not always. And they draft an application on the form that you provide. Once that application and the payment, the application fee, is submitted, and that's a word of art, okay? Because I don't want to get that confused with the word receive, because they're two different things. So when I talk about an application being submitted, that's when the applicant walks in to Bill's office, or, you know, Ellie says, here's my application, here's my $350 check. That commission, that application's been submitted as of that date. So, on applications that require a public hearing, which we'll talk about which of those there are, the receipt of an application is the next real date, and that is your next regularly scheduled meeting. That's the date of receipt, and that triggers all dates to follow. Now, if you don't have a regular meeting within 35 days of the date that the application is submitted, the application is deemed to have been received by you on day 35. So, August, no one's around. Right? Typically, you don't. Most towns don't have meetings in August. Some don't have them in July. So someone walks in at the end of, you guys do? Yeah. Someone walks in at the end of June or middle of July, submits an application. You don't have a meeting until September. The date of receipt is 35 days after that submission, when you have a meeting or not. Now, the date of receipt is the next regularly scheduled meeting. If you happen to receive it at a special meeting, which you can do, that's fine. That's the date of receipt. But if you happen to not have it on the agenda, let's say you have a special meeting where you're going to have a workshop on one topic, and you're not going to do any other business, the date of receipt would still be the date of the next regular meeting for 35 days, whichever next occurs. All right? So some towns, and I notice that, I don't think you guys do this regularly, but they have on their agendas, they have receipt date, mandatory action date, mandatory public hearing, close date. So there's little reminders on the agendas to remind all the commissioners, because there are penalties, so to speak, for keeping a public hearing open to them or not making a decision. So once you receive the application, let's start with site plan approval. The law says if the only approval that's necessary is a site plan approval, caveat, no wetlands application necessary, you have 65 days from receipt of that application to make a decision. That's 66, 65. The law says if you miss 65, the application is deemed to have been automatically granted. So, if you're coming up to the 65th day, you can't schedule another meeting because of the FOI requirements. You just can't say, let's meet again tomorrow, discuss this. And you're at, the threshold. You have to ask the applicant for an extension. So, and I had this happen to me Thursday night. I had an application, it was day 63. Commission decided all of a sudden on the site plan they wanted a public hearing. We'll talk about that in a second. And they wanted me to grant them extension for the purposes of opening a public hearing to discuss my site plan application. So I had to either say, no, I'm not going to give it to you because it's my right, applicant's right, not your right. You can ask for it, but the applicant can say no. Applicants don't say no because the alternative is, well, I got to turn your project down. I don't have enough information. So every applicant knows that. So they will grant extensions. But when you ask for an extension, or someone grants you one, be very careful as to what they are granting. Because I granted an extension on this project until the next meeting. Typically, they ask for 35 days. I don't want to give them 35 days. I want to give them 2 weeks to the next meeting. And I said, I'll talk about the next extension when you ask me for it, but I'm not going to extend further than 14 days. So that's what I gave them. So be very clear on what it is you're asking. You may say, we need a 30-day extension, and the applicant would say, well, your next meeting's in 2 weeks. Why would I give you 30 days when this could be over in 2 weeks? I'll give you 14 days. and that's what I did. So be very clear on that. So, 65 days for a site plan, unless you ask for an extension. Now, the total amount of extensions that you can ask for in any application is 65 days. In a site plan application, that means you could conceivably extend it out to 130 days with permission of the applicant. Most site plan applications don't go on that long because they are purely administrative applications. It's basically, this is what the reg requires, do I check off the box? Do I have the right scale on my map? Do I comply? Do I, you know, it's basically just a checkoff kind of thing. Now, as far as site plans are concerned, and I know, and every commission I've ever seen, save a few, always adds what I'll call conditions to every approval. You might have a set of standard conditions. There are standard conditions in almost every town. On a site plan, you're really not allowed to put conditions, what I would call conditions on the site plan approval. What you're actually doing is modifying the site plan and saying, okay, we're gonna approve this with the following modifications. And what you typically call standard conditions for the site plan approval are really modifications. Now, I've never heard anybody go to court and say, oh, you placed conditions on it, you didn't use the word modification, so therefore they're void, these modifications are void. But, you know, it doesn't help hurt to be as exact as you can. So I would suggest if you're going to ask somebody to put conditions on the site plan, you can really call it modifications. And typically those things, you might have a set of standard modifications for every site plan. Or there might be something that is in Bill's report, or in the town engineer's report. You might say, hey, we want to add these on. So you're asking, essentially you're asking him to modify his or her plan based upon the changes that, you know. Now, in some towns, they won't even do that. They'll say, come back and show me these on the plan and then I'll approve you. But that's a town that doesn't trust its staff.
So the right way to do it is ask the staff to include these modifications.
No, you're asking the applicant. You say, we're going to approve your application with the following modifications.
More often
number one for
applicants left.
Well, that's all right, because they're going to get a letter from Bill that says, hey, your project got approved last night with the following modifications. Standard modifications 1 through 5 on this. Modifications 7, 8, and 9 from Bill's memo of June 1st. You know, Jerry's memo of September 8th, whatever. So, because until they get that letter, they don't have anything. All right, so that's sort of site plan. If there are wetlands on the site, they are required to at least make an application to the Wetlands Commission on or before the date they submit an application to you. So, one of the things with wetlands applications is that there are essentially two types of wetlands applications. You don't really need to know them in great detail, but you need to know them for the business that you do. Generally speaking, either I go in and say, hey, Mr. Wetlands Commission, I don't need a permit from you. That's called the termination of permit need. I don't think I'm impacted by wetlands, but there's no wetlands on my site. I've had to go into towns and say, there's no wetlands within 1,000 feet of me. Why am I even here? Well, everybody comes. All right. So that is something they can handle in one night. If they are asking for permission,